looks like something out of a movie still, you know.
An artist? I said, yeah. And he said, is there more like you? And I said, yeah, there's a whole bunch of us up on the hill back of Algiers. And he said, oh, why don't you get them all together, and we'll have a showing, an exhibition of GI art. It'll be the first GI art exhibition in the continent of Europe, you know. So he said, but you have to get a little publicity. He said, there's a Stars and Stripes office. They just opened up right down the street. Go there and tell them there's going to be a show on, you know. And he said, oh, you're an artist? I said, yeah. He said, do you have anything of your work? I said, well, I have this little sketchbook. And he said, can I borrow it? And I said, sure. So he all of a sudden, he took the sketchbook and went back to an office back there where an officer was in the back room there. And all of a sudden, 2 minutes later, he beckons me back, you know, the room to meet the officer. And the officer said, do you want a job? You know, I said, oh boy, do I. And so they just opened up their office and they needed an artist. They had no artist. So I was the very first, and I was the last, first and last staff artist on Stars and Stripes.
No kidding.
So it was a fortuitous happening there, you know, and so it's changed my life entirely. Stars and Stripes would assign me different episodes to do, such as meeting General de Gaulle or any dignitaries. Josephine Baker, for instance, you know, I met with her. See, just prior to that, I had to cover the Russians at the fall of Berlin. Just at the close of the war. And then the very last assignment was Nuremberg. My job, of course, was to record the proceedings. Mm-hmm. And how many I would do was up to me. And I was in the press gallery of the Nurembergs, and which was very close to where the defendants were. They were the right angles to me. And I started to sketch the defendants. Hermann Göring was the closest to me, so I concentrated on him. And then next to him was Hess. Mm-hmm. And then Keitel was next to him. And I only did the first row of defendants. And I did the judges, you know, Speaker Alderman and the German Defense Council. And I worked with a fountain pen, which is kind of a gutsy to, you know, because you can't make a mistake when you work with a fountain pen, because whatever you draw, that's it for life, you know.
And use the term fountain pen and spit.
Yeah.
What's that mean?
Well, I didn't have any water with me.
Yeah.
And the drawings are in halftone.
Yeah.
And the only way you get a halftone, I was using a soluble ink, which was not permanent ink. So you could push it around. You'd wet your fingers with your tongue, and rub it on. And I did it right on the spot, you know. So I pulled it off, you know. Göring seemed to be in charge, you know. He had the feeling. He gave the feeling that he was still running the show. I got the impression that he had his uniform on, but he had lost a lot of weight. You know, he was pretty heavy, mm-hmm. And I kept thinking of like a. I kept thinking when a parachute lands, you know, it billows out and it gets kind of billowy, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was kind of sunken in his uniform a little bit. It kind of was loose around him, you know. Remind me of a deflated parachute around him, you know. Hess next to him was, he had his head in the book. I kept reading. And so I had a hard time, I had to wait for him to get his head up to do a likeness of him, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I worked through a pair of field glasses. Because I to do portraits, you have to get as close as you can, but you got to zero in on the heads, and they were actually about 25 feet from me,
mm-hmm.
And that's a little too far to do a portrait. So you got to zero in on the heads. So and the thing is, nobody knows this. I'm confessing this now, though the field glasses I borrowed from somebody, or somebody gave them to me. I don't remember what, if I borrowed them or somebody gave them to me. They were in reverse.
Ah.
So if you look at the Göring, he's facing the opposite way that he should be. And nobody's never noticed that he's facing. But it came out fine, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I should have flipped the finished product, you know, because everybody else is facing the proper way,
yeah, yeah.
For some reason. But with him, I use the glasses, and so I did a good job of concentrating them. So I didn't know quite how to handle this. You know, I never did this before. So I found the only way you can do this using a pair of binoculars is to freeze it on your glasses. I had my glasses on, and don't move the glasses. Let your eyeballs go up and down without moving that, because you'll jar it. If you move, the head goes back and forth, and it's very disconcerting. So you can only use your eyeballs to go up and down to your sketch pad and the head of the person that you're drawing. Yeah. You've got to keep it frozen in place. Yeah. So only your eyeballs can go up and down. So it's very difficult to do.
Well, literally, so you're right-handed. So
I'm right-handed. I'm holding the glasses, and my eyeballs has to go up and down. I had the sketch pad on my lap.
Yeah.
And I managed it. It worked out all right, you know. But it was very difficult to do, and I didn't realize you would have that problem to zero in on the defendant's faces, you know. But they all came out well. Little notes to them whenever I could to get my impression of their demeanor, you know. And put in the press gallery, and I did a drawing of some of the press people, you know. So what I sent you, I did about three of them, because I turned around, and I also did the guard. He was standing right next to me, a Scots guard, and since he was standing so quiet, you know, I said, "Oh, I'll draw him too." But everybody looked so bedraggled, you know, and downtrodden. Everybody had their head down. It was cold, and it was November, you know, but everybody looked scurrying around the streets of Nuremberg with their heads down. Mm-hmm. It impressed me. And everything was gray, mousy gray. Of course, the time of the year, too, was gray, but the people looked... a little decrepit, you know, and heads down. I remember that. And usually you have people walking around with the heads up. No, they were all looking very dejected to me. And I made a drawing later for an illustration. I used that photograph of the bread line. People just all lined up getting their bread, and I put two German soldiers overseeing the whole thing, you know, it was published in, I think, in This Week magazine. I did a lot of work for them. So I just incorporated the photograph and drawings of two Germans overseeing the bread line, you know. I found my pass for the Nuremberg, to get into the Nuremberg. Yeah, I have it right here, you know.
What did you think when you were focusing on the premier defendant? It was Gehring.
It's very hard to have any thoughts except delineating, capturing the likenesses. You know, I'm not listening into the proceedings. Of course, they'd be in several languages, of course, and my concentration was nailing their personalities down.
Right.
And then I made the little notations, you know, with my feelings a little bit, but that was limited. And everybody was very professional as far as the judges and everybody. Well, it just stands to be that they're going to be, very professional in their jobs. I keep picturing in my mind about the end of the trials when they were executing all of them, and I've seen pictures of that execution room, you know. Oh, that's always bothered me, you know.
Right.
You know, thinking of their endings, you know. I think I'm the only one that covered the Nuremberg in drawings, and he said, "Oh, he think there was a Russian that came in." And I never saw his work. Were they ever published? Do you know anything about that?
Soviet artist Boris Efimov. And Kukriniksi trio, whose ruthless pencils had already exposed and pilloried the criminals in their caricatures.
Unbelievable man. This is, Ed, I can't tell you how much fun I've had.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
This has been wonderful for me, and I know I've taken up a lot of your time here today, but this is fabulous.
Well, it's a lot of my history.